nga din nakapagpigil pa ang Umanoy anak-anakan ni Kibuloy sa KOJC at inamin na din nito ang lahat ng nalalaman sa Umanoy kawalang yan ang nasabing pastor. Narito panoorin ang makatindig balahibong pagbubulgar ng anak-anakan ni Kibuloy.
So at this point, kung pwede ko nang tawagin yung isa sa mga victim survivors na magsasalita sa atin ngayong hapon, alias Miss Marie. Willing po ba kayo magbahagi ng karanasan mo? Briefly, pero ano yung pinaka-importanting yung kwentong buhay mo na gusto mong sabihin sa aming komite? You have the floor.
Good afternoon, Madam Chair, Senator Risa Hontiveros, and everybody present in this hall. Ako, Ailas Marie Josephine, Filipino, nasa legal na edad at naninirahan sa Davao City. Matapos na makanumpa na naaayon sa batas ay malaya at kusang loob na naglalahad ng mga sumusunod. Ako ay dating membro ng Kingdom of Jesus Christ o KOJC simula nung ako ay grade 5. Naging membro ako ng KOJC dahil in-endorse ako ng aking mama matapos siyang maging avid televiewer ni Pastor Kibuloy sa kanyang mga programa at enrollment iyon ng pasukan. Ayon sa kagustuhan ng mama ko, napagdesisyonan niyang ilagay ako sa KOJC para mapunta ako sa safe environment kasi natatakot siya na may mangyari raw masama sa akin kasi may itsura daw ako. Sa pagkakaalala ko, noong June 2013, dinala ako na mama ko sa KOJC. Nag-attend kami ng Thanksgiving and worship presentation sa KOJC Cathedral. Napaka-welcoming ng mga membro ng KOJC sa amin kasi kusa naman kaming nag-attend ng service worship nila. Sa pagkakataong iyon, nakuha namin ang attention ni Nelly Canada na sa pagkakaalam ko ay may mataas na katungkulan sa Jose Maria College o JMC bilang dean o administrator. Pagkatapos ng worship, in-invite kami ni Mama na ipakilala kay Kibuloy sa dating Victoria's Building kung saan doon kumakain si na Kibuloy at malalapit sa kanya pagkatapos ng worship. Nelly Canada let us meet Pastor and endorse ako ni Mama kay Kibuloy. Habang kumakain sila Kibuloy, kasama ang mga pastoral sa isang malaking round table, nag-usap ng saglit ang Mama ko at si Kibuloy. And Nelly Canada also let me meet Pastor Kibuloy. Sa aking pagkakaalala, 12 years old ako that time. Nasa grade 5 ako noon. Narinig ko si Kibuloy na sinabihan si Nelly Canada na patirahin ako sa dorm. Sa pagkakataong iyon, natuwa ako kasi sa isip ko magkakaroon ako ng freedom since medyo hindi naman kami in good terms ni Mama. Ipinakita sa amin ang mga kwarto doon sa dorm at maayos naman ang mga kalagayan nito. Kinabukasan, kasama si Nelly Canada, kinuha namin ang mga gamit ko sa bahay, sakay ng isang Innova ng KOJC. At simula noon, doon ako pinatira sa loob ng compound. Habang nasa loob ng KOJC, nakatira ako sa dorm, kasama ng ibang mga miyembro. Sa pagkakaalala ko, nag-aaral ako ng grade 5 sa JMC, habang binabayaran ng papa ko ang tuition ko, ngunit may discount bilang miyembro ng KOJC. Sa pang-araw-araw na pamumuhay doon, tinuruan kami na lahat ng gagawin namin ay nakabase sa schedule. Sa umaga, magigising kami para mag-devotional na alas 4 o alas 5. Pagkatapos ng devotional, gagawin namin ang mga assigned tasks o work job na tinatawag kagaya ng pagmamap ng sahig, pagwawalis, pagpunas ng mga furniture sa common area at paglinis ng kwarto. Isang house parent namin ang nag-a-assign ng work job. Naalala ko din na kapag gusto namin lumabas ng compound, madaming dadaan ang proseso at hindi sa lahat ng pagkakataon ay mapapayagan lumabas ng compound. Noong senior high ako, pinalipat ako sa ibang quarters kung saan nakatira ang isang leader na kasama ko. Sa panahong ito, nagsisilbi na ako bilang member ng choir. Kalaunan, na-assign ako sa pastoral department. Meron pa din akong work job at minsan nagsaserve ng pagkain ni pastor. Sa panahon iyon, napapansin ko parati niya kasama sa kainan si Stephanie Ibarra, na isa ring pastoral sa inner circle. Sa pagkakaalam ko, at alam din ng lahat na paborito ni pastor si Stephanie Ibarra, parati kasama ni Kibuloy Stephanie kahit saan siya magpunta. Mga taong 2017, naimbitahan ako na kumain sa JMC lobby kasama si Kibuloy at ng iba pang mga inner pastoral. Nalaman ko kalaunan na kapag nakakasama ka na sa ganitong groupings ay malapit ka na mapagbilang sa inner pastoral. Naranasan ko ang ganitong routine ng mga ilang buwan. Pagkatapos ng mga ilang buwan, isang gabi, inibita ako ng isang inner pastoral na si Patricia. Sabi niya sa akin, Marie, pinapatawag ka ni Sir kasi sabay daw tayo maghilot, be presentable. Pagkatapos noon, nag-prepare ako, nagligo ako at inayos ko ang aking sarili. Sinamahan ako ni Patricia sa isang private theater ni Kibuloy. Pagdating ko doon, nakita ko si Jacqueline Roy at ibang inner pastoral na nag-aabang sa anumang iutos ni Kibuloy. Habang siya ay nakaupo sa kanyang recliner chair habang nanonood ng movie, pagdating namin doon, binulungan ako ni Patricia na pumesto sa may kaliwang paa ni Kibuloy. Hinilot ni Patricia ang kanang paa habang ako ay nagsimula na maghilot sa kaliwang paa. Si Jacqueline Roy naman ang nagmamasahe sa balikat ni Kibuloy. At sa pagkakataong iyon, naramdaman ko na privilege ako kasi hindi lahat may opportunity na makasama si Kibuloy or ang itinuturing namin na anak ng Diyos or appointed son. Sa tuwing nagtotestify ang mga inner pastoral sa worship or may event or team building, parati sila nagpapasalamat sa pribilehiyo na binigay ni Kibuloy sa kanila. Kaya iyon ang nakatatak sa isip namin ng mga membro. Ang mga pastoral kasi ang itinuturing na most privileged sa Kingdom Nation dahil sila naman ang pinakamalapit kay Kibuloy at nakakasama niya sa iba't ibang lugar at bansa at napaka well provided. Simula naghilot ako sa kanya, binigyan ako ni Patricia ng 5,000 pesos kada linggo na pinapabigay daw ni Pastor sa akin bilang allowance ko. Pinapalipat din ako ni Jacqueline Roy sa kwarto ni Patricia kung saan malapit ito sa kwarto ni Kibuloy. Naranasan ko rin maisama sa Hong Kong at magstay sa isang 5-star hotel kasama ang mga inner pastoral. Binigyan din ako ng pocket money na pambili ng anumang gustuhin ko. Nagsimula rin ako maglinis sa kwarto ni Kibuloy kasama ang ibang mga pastoral. Hindi kasi lahat ng membro pwede pumasok sa kwarto ni Kibuloy. Nung naging pastoral na ako, pinagbawalan ako ng mga nakakatandang inner pastoral na pumunta sa mga lugar na madaming lalaki o makipagkaibigan sa mga lalaki. Bilang membro ng KOJC, pinagbabawalan rin kami na magkaroon ng boyfriend o gumamit ng cellphone at pinagbabawal pa kami ng iba't pang mga bagay. Noong naramdaman ko na mapapabilang ako sa inner pastoral, madami ako natanggap na mga bagay kagaya ng pabango, chocolate, damit na galing ibang bansa at iba pa. Ulit-ulit na lang ang ganitong routine sa aking buhay ng ilang taon sa loob ng KOJC compound noong February 2023. Dahil sa kagustuhan kong makapag-aral ng kolehiyo sa labas at sa paniwala ko naman may kakayanan akong makapag-aral, lumayas ako sa KOJC compound at hindi na bumalik doon. Noong araw na mismo na iyon, pumunta ako kay Patricia dahil alam kong lumayas na din siya sa KOJC compound sa panahong iyon. Doon ko nalaman na inutusan siya ni Jacqueline Roy na ihanda ako para maging membro ng inner pastoral. Sinabi ni Patricia na kinausap din siya ni Kibuloy para ihanda ako na maging membro ng inner circle. Inamin din niya na si Kibuloy. Inamin din niya na lahat ng akusasyon na sexual exploitation laban kay Kibuloy na inaakusa ng mga lumabas na ng pastoral ay totoo. Inamin din ni Patricia na inaalay nila ang katawan, isip, kaluluwa at spirito nila kay Kibuloy para sa mga sexual na gawain at paghihilot ay umpisa lang ng duty sa pagiging inner circle pastoral. Ayon sa kanya, sabi ni Patricia, dito sa panahong ito, sinisubukan ni Kibuloy kung handa na ba ang isang inner pastoral para ialay ang katawan, isip at kaluluwa para sa kanya. At nung nalaman ko iyon, nagtampo ko kay Patricia kasi pakiramdam ko ilalagay niya pala ako sa kapamakan. At hindi niya ako sinabihan. sa mangyayari sa akin. Pero nagpapasalamat naman ako dahil nakaalis na ako doon sa compound. At hindi ako napagsamandalahan. Kaya ako nagsasalita ngayon dahil as former member, alam ko na ang buong operasyon ng QGC ay bawang panlilin lang lamang. Yun lang po, Madam Chair.
Maraming salamat sa iyo, Marie. Ilang follow-up questions lang, okay? Kung maaari. Okay?
Yes, Madam Chair.
All right. So, bilang muntik nang naging inner pastoral, bilang naging pastoral, ano yung paniniwala mo sa katauhan ni Kiboloy at kailangan nyo siyang pagsilbihan? Meron pa ba ka, ikaw idadagdag na ano yung mga gawain nyo at ano naman din may idadagdag ka pa bang anong pinagbabawal sa inyo?
Sa experience ko po, besides sa work job nung nandun pa ako sa loob, ako ay na-assign sa Kingdom Children Growth School or Global Child Evangelism. Kaya besides sa life namin doon sa quarters namin na naglilinis kami, nag-serve kami, ako ay may duties din doon na everyday doon ako. And back then, ang tunay na panihin ko talaga kay Pastor is father figure. Kasi lumaki naman ako na walang ama. And po, Manchir.
Salamat, Miss Marie. Sabi mo nga 11 years old ka nang ipagkatiwala ka, no? Ng iyong mama sa KOJC. So, a few years after na inumpisahan kang i-groom para maging pastoral, so you were on your way to being part of the inner circle ng mga pastoral. At maraming beses binanggit mo si Jacqueline Roy bilang bahagi ng prosesong iyon. So, meron ka bang idadagdag pa kung bakit nasabi mo iyon na papunta ka na talaga sa gagawing kang inner pastoral? Meron pa bang ibang palatandaan na malapit ka nang maisali dun sa inner circle ni Kiboloy?
Kasi nang lumabas si Patricia at inanong ako ni Kiboloy kung handa ka na ba na ialay ang body, mind, soul, spirit mo para sa anak, he is referring to himself. At sabi niya na dito sa tanong niya sa akin kasi parang lately lang na lumabas si Patricia nun kung ano gusto ko sa future ko sa KOJC. Sabi niya, akong leader ba along those lines? Ang sagot ko lang, gusto ko lang kasi like masave yung soul ko. Yun talaga yung pinanghahawakan ko dati. Yun po, Madam Chair.
So, yung mga senyales mo na papunta ka na sa gagawin kang inner pastoral ay hindi lamang kay Jacqueline Roy pero kay Kiboloy mismo sa ganung mga pananalita at gawain nila.
Yes po, Ma'am Chair.
Okay. And eventually, hindi natuloy ito hanggang makatakas ka nga last year. So, bago ko itanong yung paano ka nakatakas, paano nangyari yun, pinag-massage ka rin, ano, nung pastoral ka pa at malapit nang gagawing inner pastoral?
Sabay po kami ni Patricia.
Sabay kayo ni Patricia. So, tig-isang paa na pinamasahe. Okay. So, paano nangyaring na nakatakas ka nung nakaraang taon?
Nung nakaraan po, ibabalik na sana ako sa Tamayong kasi doon kami nag-aaral ng Bible School. Yun yung school na ACQ College of Ministries. And personally, gusto ko talaga makapagtapos ng kolehiyo na totoong kurso, maging professional, ganun po. Kaya po, hindi ko na po kaya na mamuhay sa pang-araw-araw namin na ganun po, na hindi, wala kaming choice. May, sinasabi may freedom of choice. Pero naka-instruction naman lahat. Yun po, Madam Chair, kaya lumayas po ako. Hindi po ako napaalam. Lumayas po ako kasi kapag papaalam ako, napaalam na kaya Jacqueline Roy before.
And kung pwede mong sabihin sa amin in public, paano ka nakatakas? Unless hindi mo pwedeng sabihin. Okay lang kung hindi kaya, sabihin mo lang sa akin kung kaya mong sabihin or hindi.
Ay, beg po, Madam Chair, na hindi po sasabihin.
Okay, so at least hindi mo sabihin in public. Huling tanong ko sa iyo sa ngayon, no, Miss Marie, at sinabi din ito ng ibang mga resource persons natin, pati mga magulang, maraming mga bata ang nasa poder ng kingdom. Dahil bata ka pa nung nag-umpisa sa KOJC, ano yung mga obserbasyon at mga nalalaman mo na mga nangyayari sa mga batang miyembro?
Isa po sa mga na-observe ko po doon, like recently lang po last year, may case po about sa bata sa Indangan na sexually molest, na molest siya ng isang LGBTQ na member. Lalaki po siya na bata. Nurse po siya supposedly. Tapos I don't know po kung na-raise nila to legally. And I know po na hindi lang po ito isang kaso na may batang namolest siya sa ibang properties ng KOJC.
Okay, maraming salamat, Miss Marie. So, paki-stay on hanggat mag-adjourn tayo ng pagdinig just in case may iba pang at kaugnay na tanong sa iyo. Okay? Maraming salamat. Ituloy mo yung pangarap mong makapagtapos at i-pursue yung profesyon na iniisip mo para sa sarili mo. Okay?
Salamat.
Oh, okay, salamat din po. Tanong po kay... Nandito ba si... si Sir Dindo, I think online po ba kayo, sir? Yes, Sir Dindo, naririnig niyo po ba kami?
Yes po, yes po, Madam Chair.
Okay, salamat sir. Hello po. Ilang mga tanong lamang po sa inyo siguro, or meron po ba kayong maikling mensaheng gustong ibigay sa aming komite? Although, baka Sir Dindo, dahil nakapag bigay na po kayo ng testimonya nung naunang hearing, kumaari dalawang follow-up questions mula sa akin sa ngayon. Salamat po, Sir Dindo. Ganong kalawak na phenomenon yung marriage fraud? Common practice po ba yon sa loob ng kingdom?
Opo, Madam Chair. Magandang hapon po pala. Good afternoon, everyone, especially Madam Chair and also the other senators that are also doing online and even for all the guests that is in the present that in your forum right now. Yes, I think it's really widely practiced because it's from Toronto, Canada to Vancouver. So meaning to say it's from the East Coast to the West Coast. And as I understand that it is happening from different cities also, including Alberta, Canada, and some other areas by which they execute this kind of sham marriages. Yeah. And Madam Chair, if you don't mind, I have some actually slides that I want to share. These are really important to really sum up also with some of the issues that has been shared by some of our other witnesses and also General Torre that also is investigating. And I can show you some slides if you may. I would like to share this. Now, I would like
especially
us to know that,
I think
nothing
Sir Dindo,
happens.
I think, Sir Dindo, yeah. Yung presentation nyo kaugnay din ng money laundering, ano po. So please do proceed
yes,
with
I
your
have.
Slides.
I have those.
You have the floor.
Thank you so much, Madam. And I just would like us to know that the leadership chart of KOJC, nothing happens in KOJC without the knowledge of ASAQ, which is Apollo C. Kibuloy. So down to his board of administrators, to his coordinators and ministers, and then he deselected leaders among these groups all over Canada to mend those human trafficking that are brought in different places of all Canada. So it really begins when he has a King is Coming tour. When they come to Canada, he brings like almost 125 to 150 full-time miracle workers, which includes pulpit workers, concert singers, Those are also who are setting up crew for his live telecast. And these people, they remain in Canada or in USA to do fundraising and solicitation in all of Canada. So caroling, solicit person to person, from malls, business to business, parking lots, residential and care homes, using CGF as soliciting organization, raising funds, capitalizing the marginalized children wherever, whenever there is earthquake, also on typhoons, they also use such an operation.
Kayo so po yung nasa photos kanina, that, ano po, Sir Dindo?
Yes, I am the one doing this fundraising because photos, I really was, yes. I believe on Pastor Apostle Apollo Sikibuli when I was converted. I have given my whole heart, whole full sincerity to support his mission. And that is the reason why I left my 65,000 yearly income to a 1,000 month income when I hand, when I lead his CGF Foundation in Canada, because I am the executive director of CGF Canada since 2016. And so, if you can see all the slides, these are my children that was supposed to be with him, and they are being sent to Manila to do fundraising, as you see all of these names and also some of the slides. Those are my sons and my daughters who are being involved in all of these practices. And also, those are the pictures. Another one also, what accommodation they will provide them. Can you show the, these are the provisions of the sleeping places where the kids are really, I do not know if that is life that were there you are seeing there. And then the next slides. And also here, my son, who is also a minor, is also used by SMNI to do all of this, job in the filming industry. Now, I would like us to also know that the moment that they collected money, the following day, when they collect money, I am one of the person that they will ask to send money. And if you can see the screen, I sent money to Teresita Dandan. This is 209,500.
Sir Dindo, yung pangalan lang yun, yes. There was also sa testimony kanina ni Ate Gingging, ni Ms. Teresita, meron ding siyang binanggit na Tessie Dandan. So maybe this is the same person.
Yes, Madam Chair, she is the same person. She is one of the Board of Administrator assigned in the USA. Okay,
okay, and then
the
proceed, next, Sir Dindo.
Yeah, and then the next here is we have Dana Margina. There is also another person named Ingrid Canada, which is, I believe, she is in the forum right now. Ingrid Canada, Bringas Mabel, and also there's another one. Pumikpik is the name, Marlene Pumikpik. I also send all this this money. What happened is when the money is collected for the whole night, which full-time workers in the streets, they come home almost early morning just to meet their quota. And then when they arrive, they will be counting the money. And then the people in the Treasury Department, they're going to ask someone from the members or full-time workers to send it to the Philippines right away without documentation from the CRA, which is Canada Revenue Canada, without any record that is kept here, so that it will be a tax or whatever things that the government wants to know how Children's Joy Foundation is operating and also the KOJC is operating. Now, I am one of the victims of his sham marriage. That's the reason why my children were already grown up when I brought them to Canada. But thank God I rescued them from Davao, and they were released from Davao, and I was able to brought them here in Canada. I was asked to marry Maria Noraline Barrientos because her visa is expiring. And that my children was, I asked the minister, Dandy Cabahog, to bring my children to Davao, because I thought that they will be properly, and I can see that they have nurtured them, teaching them how to play music and everything, but I was not aware that they were being child trafficking to many parts in Manila and also in many parts of Davao and Mindanao. And so I got married to this person and then I filed a divorce after those few years. And
Sir
here
Dindo,
in Canada, I want to mention this.
Oh, Sir Dindo, yung ganitong klase yes, ng operations ng marriage fraud, ongoing pa ba sila?
I cannot say yes because I have been away from them since 2019. But since, you know, this has been a modus operandi of KOJC, not only in Canada, USA, Brazil, and even in the different parts of the country of the world, by which they want a worker from Davao to have a permanent status so that their existence there will continue to perpetuate. That's the recent thing. And I just want to mention this, Madam Chair. The administrator here in Canada, which is the sister of Ingrid Canada, Marie-Thier Canada, is also one of a sham marriage here. So get married to one of the worker. One also is Elizabeth Carrion is also one because she was a previous board of administrator here in Canada. And Ferdinand Cabahog, which is Dandy Cabahog in the schematic plan from the police. Jeremiah Carrion, Marvin Reynes, Arlene Rillon, Zar Buenafe, Beric Nana, and many, many more names that I can give to you to prove to the fact that these sham marriages are really happening. And as I told you, I am one of the victim of this scheme. Another thing also that I want to add is that Rosalie Magnaong appointed me she's the in charge of the Philippine of the CGF Philippines and also in Canada and Australia and Nepal. And Hong Kong, which is not really registered, CGF is not even registered there. But the head of all the operations is still ACQ, which is Apollo Sikibuloy, who controls the withdrawals of funds, particularly from CGF Canada bank accounts, of which funds were used not for children's benefit, but the benefit of certain personalities and KOJC Canada Church's operations. In 2016, Rosalie Magnaong hired me to assist with the possible rebooking of their license by the CRA. Reason for that, because there has been a report of misappropriation of funds, which I tried to justify to the CRA. But I want us this forum to know that in KOJC, telling lies and cover up of KOJC is a normal part of their culture from the very beginning. That is how they groom. Lies and cover up. Some of these full-time medical workers who are in the streets for more than 12 to 16 hours soliciting to pay off luxurious cars and mansions, which I'm a witness of the mansions being owned here, instead of feeding hungry, destitute children in the Philippines.
Thank you very
much. These are the reasons why.
Yes, Sir Dindo, meron pa po sa presentation niyo.
I will be closing now,
yes,
Madam.
Please,
but these are the reasons why the CGF was closed. Can I continue, Madam?
Yes, please do. Please
do. Yeah, okay. Thank you so much, Madam Chair. Failure to devote resources to charitable activities. That's the reason why CGF, that's number one, why they were closed here. Number two, failure to be constituted for exclusively charitable purposes. Number three, failure to issue receipts in accordance with the Act of and its regulations, because here in Canada every donations requires a receipt so they can present it to the CRA for tax deductions. Failure to maintain adequate books and records, because the reason why I left, because I cannot justify all of the expenses, including sending 60,000 just to pay off fuel for a jet, which I said this is not for children's purposes, but this is for personal purposes of whoever. For the proof of the file can be found in the internet. Now, I want us to understand that ACQ controls CGF Canada through his administrator, Marie-Thier Canada, who does all the instruction of withdrawals from CGF bank accounts, especially the 60,000 that I already mentioned. Now, this is not only 60,000, Madam Chair. This is millions of dollars being collected from September to February, that is the month of blessing, aside from January to December, which is 365 days of money laundering, collecting the money from the Canadian public instead of giving it to the hungry people in the Philippines. They use it and send it right away to the accounts aforementioned in my presentation. So whenever ECQ full-time workers reported to the police for any abuses such as rudeness, and they have some human rights violation, like one of the worker, full-time worker, tried to entice a mentally challenged boy, and she even went to the bank machine, insert the bank machine of that boy, and then collected money, more than $500 from that boy. And she's been like at large now, but she's been, the police has been looking for her, but they send her to Australia. And that is how this operation is happening. When you are not allowed to work on a certain country, they will send you to some other countries. Like I was in Australia because I was the one who opened, assigned to open CGF in Australia. But they are now under investigation, so much so here in Canada. Now,
thank you.
I want to close this.
Sir Dindo?
Yes, I'm closing now, yes, madam. Please. This will be the last. I left this organization after I have seen all of these lies and financial manipulation that includes my mother, Andrea Garcia Larson, who is not rich, but have given ACQ almost 3 million peso because she believes on him. As her sacrifice offering, not minding she has no more money for her retirement. She died with COVID in 2022. I sent an info to Rose Di Magnaon that my mother died. I never have received any sympathy from them. And aside from that, the same year when my mother gave this money to Apollo Sikibuloy, my children were taken off from the scholarship of his institution, which is Jose Maria College, which I really feel bad as a father who has been working for him and working for his ministry with all my whole heart, because I give my heart to his ministry and I was treated like this. I feel bad that when my mother died, they just ignore. His doctrine are deceitful claims, a blasphemy to the Son of God. But may I speak to Pastor Apollo Sikibuloy, Madam Chair, if you allow me?
Sir Dindo, I would allow that sa parehong paraan kay Miss Yulia kanina through the chair, kaya lang medyo ginigipit na po tayo sa oras. But if you would like to put your message to Kibuloy in writing, pwede po naming itanong sa korte if they will allow it to be sent to him, kung maaari po, Sir Dindo.
Yes, ma'am.
Salamat po. Maraming salamat. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
Sa pag-participate.
Thank you so much for this
challenge. Thank you so much, Sir Dindo. I'm sorry about your mother, but I hope na kayo na mga anak mo, you're really rehabilitating your life together now. Salamat po, Sir Dindo.
Yes.
Dako naman po ako briefly sa kina Ms. Kath Cortez ng NUJP, at Ms. Edita Caduaya ng Mindanao Independent Press Council. Andito, yes ma'am. Salamat Ms. Edita. Ms. Edita, sa coverage nyo po dun sa law enforcement operations para arestohin si Kibuloy, ano po yung na-observe nyo? Meron po bang nangyaring police brutality dun sa narrative po na iyon?
So far, walang police brutality sa part namin. Kami yung na-brutalized.
Oh, paano po nangyari yon?
Kasi every media member na pumunta doon na members of the press, we've been subjected to harassment, intimidation, threat. Uh-huh. And it came to a point na ako mismo, hinarap ko sila kasi if hindi ko sila tuturuan kung paano masaktan, paano nila ma-feel yung na-feel namin.
Mm-hmm. Actually, yun yung pangalawang at huling tanong ko, naharass po ba ang media at saan galing yung harassment na yon? Sa PNP ba? Sa KOJC ba? Sa iba pa?
Nung day one, that was August 24, feeling namin we were cheated of the basic information from both ends. Uh-huh. Alam na Attorney Torian ran. Hindi kami lumabas si Attorney Torian, nandiyan siya. Alam ni Director Torre, day one, we were at the roadside, lumapit, lumabas si Attorney Torre, na-accommodate naman kami. Later on, lumabas si Director Torre, na-accommodate naman kami. That was August 24. On August 25th, ito na yung first confrontation ng members of the press with some members of KOGC sa main highway.
Okay.
Ito yung August 25. And August 26, 1 o'clock in the afternoon, 1:30 in the afternoon, ako as president of MIPC, I went to see Attorney Torion and the General Torre. Nagpapirma kami ng papel para yung for a harmonious relationship, harmonious coverage. Mm-hmm. That was 1:30 in the afternoon. After 5 hours, about approximately 6 hours, yun, nagsimula na naman yung nahulog yung taga TV5. Then nasundan 9 o'clock in the evening. That was 9:10 in the evening. Ako na yung na-confront ng members ng KOGC. In fairness naman kay Attorney Torion, every time nagdadaing kami sa kanya, he kept on apologizing. It came to a point na nagtatanong kami with this beauteous sprawling 30 hectare property covered with plastic Bermuda. There are plastic people inside. Kasi nasasaktan na kami. I'm sorry, pero may mga mababait na super bait. May mga tuso talaga po. And we were not... Ang kalaban namin is kami yung legitimate na nagko-cover. Kami pa yung tinatawag na bayaran na sila man yung tumatanggap. Kami na nga yung... I'm not referring to the key officials here. Okay? But this is a question of leadership. Hindi namin tanggap na pinuputang ina kami ng mga members ng KOGC habang nanun siya nag-aamin-amin. Parang ano kayo, banal? Eh kami yung makasalanan? Yun yung Pastor, I know, Madam Chair,
that yes, Ms. Editha, please don't address the other resource persons directly. Through the chair na lamang.
Madam Chair, I know that the pastor is here. I would like to tell him, with the experience we have had, we are asking and questioning what went wrong with the religious teachings.
Okay po.
Kayo lang ba yung santo at kami yung makasalanan?
Okay po.
And okay. Ito yung pinaka-unfair. We were craving for information from both ends. But kami na naka-ID, kami nagtatago ng ID. Kasi ang SMNI people were ganging us up. Lahat naman sila media, kami komedya. Ano yun? Eh kami naman yung may mga lisensya eh. Lahat naman na sinasabi nila, like, may lockdown sa airport, hindi namin alam kasi hindi nangyari. Pito yung namatay, isa ang sinabi na Attorney Torion, isa lang yung na-confirm na Attorney Torion, which ginawa namin. Eh kami naman yung fake. Eh ano bang totoo? Eh kami na nga yung naghihingi ng pabor, eh kami pa yung masama. And it came to a point na we were asking the BOA, Attorney Torion, na give us the access, no, na makapasok. Ang sabi niya, he needs to ask the Board of Administrators, of which number to 350 people to get their approval, and that would be siguro isang buwan bago mangyari, and that was September 3. Ano at September 2? On September 3, after the press conference, dahil may daring game sila ni General Torre, bigla kaming hinatak sa basement na hindi kami na-brief ano yung mangyayari sa amin doon.
Okay. Ms. Editha, at any point, nakaranas ba kayo personally ng pananakit mula sa KOJC or SMNI or even PNP?
Pananakit na physical kami?
Apo.
O malapitang inkwentro? Ano ba?
Either.
May nahulog po na taga-TV5.
Yung taga-TV5.
May
okay,
video kami. It's a but I'm sorry, it takes 12 minutes. Kasi nandun lahat since day 1 hanggang natapos.
Okay. Siguro po dahil nga po sa usapin ng panahon, Ms. Editha, ma-appreciate po ng komite kung isubmit nyo sa amin yung kopya ng 12-minute video para po sa committee report namin, findings and recommendations. Pero palagay ko, mahalaga na po na nasabi nyo both sa KOJC at sa PNP leadership yung mga feedback nyo sa naging karanasan nyo sa coverage and yung mga improvements na gusto nyo makita moving forward. So maraming salamat po sa presensya at saka sa inputs nyo
Madam
dito
Chair,
sa hearing na ito,
just...
Ms. Editha. Kita.
My group is listening and
yes.
watching you right now.
Yes.
Can we just ask the chairperson of the Committee on Women and Children mm. that the Senate can improve or amend the policy about the coverage involving women and children,
okay.
especially in a hostile situation. Okay. And I hope that you can talk with the Committee on Information, Public Information, because the midterm election is approaching and we mm. need at least a cloth of security from the government and the PNP. So we can work well. And that's all, Madam Chair. Thank you.
Yes, thank you din, Ms. Editha. Lalo na sa pagbibigay nyo sa amin ng isang konkreto pang in aid of legislation. Ano po? Tama naman kayo yung pagpapaganda dun sa batas tungkol sa coverage in yung ganitong mga either tense or even dangerous situations, particular sa kababaihan at kabataan. And well taken po yung pwede kami makipagtrabaho sa Senate Committee on Public Information. Maraming salamat, Ms. Editha. Bago tayo dumako sa mga government agencies and then finally yung ways forward na may inputs mula sa NGOs at saka sa government agencies din natin, bigyan ko ng pagkakataon individually si Mr. Crescente Canada, si Ms. Ingrid Canada, si Ms. Jacqueline Roy, si Ms. Pauline Canada at si Sylvia Semanyes. One after the other, kung meron po kayong gustong iresponde sa mga victim survivors na nagsalita. So feel free to express what you want to say to them or about yung mga testimonyo nila through the chair. So yeah, kahit tig isang minuto, take at least 1 minute. Mr. Canada muna.
Magandang hapon po.
Magandang hapon. Iharap niyo po yung mic sa inyo.
Magandang hapon po, Madam Chair. I invoke my right to remain silent. Tapos, sa korte lang po ako sumasagot sa lahat ng mga akusasyon sa akin po. Salamat po.
All right. Salamat din, Mr. Canada. Ms. Ingrid Canada.
Good afternoon, Madam Chair. I'm also invoking my rights to remain silent.
All right, salamat Ms. Canada. Ms. Jacqueline Roy.
Thank you for this opportunity, Madam Chair. Still, my answer is the same. I am invoking my right to remain silent and the right against self-incrimination. Thank you.
All right, salamat Ms. Roy. Ms. Pauline Canada.
Good afternoon, Madam Chair. And also, Madam Chair, with all due respect, I'm invoking my rights to remain silent and against self-incrimination. Thank you.
All right. Salamat din. And Ms. Semanyes.
Good afternoon, Madam Chair. Also, I invoke my right to remain silent po.
All right. So at least binigyan kayo ng komite ng pagkakataon na magkomento sa alinman sa mga testimonya ng mga victim survivors. So anyway, so maraming salamat sa inyo. So pwede pa tayong dumako ngayon sa mga government agencies natin. Sa DSWD, nasaan po yung resource person ng DSWD? Si Ms. Charito Esteban. Nakapagsumpa kayo kanina, ma'am? Okay. Salamat po. So, Ms. Charito, narinig po natin sa ilan sa mga victim survivors natin yung tungkol sa trafficking operations, lalong-lalo na halimbawa para dun sa tinatawag na Month of Blessings, na nagpapatuloy pa rin yun kahit habang dinadaos natin itong investigasyon. May mga efforts po ba ang department para i-address yun?
Good afternoon, Madam Chair. With regards to the trafficking and abuse made, conduct a rescue in Region 11 in Davao in particular. It's not happened that particularly in our office, Sanders Bureau, but it is in collaboration with our DSWD Field Office 11. We will submit a report regarding this matter with regards to the collaboration made with our field offices. Thank you, Madam.
Okay. Salamat po. At baka pwede rin habang nagba-budget hearings ang Senado para kung may anumang mga programa na nag-a-address kumukontra sa trafficking operations sa ilalim ng department, ma-check din po ng Senado o ng buong Kongreso na sufficiently supported yon. Okay po. Ano po yung... Sorry. Narinig din po natin mula sa marami o marami-rami sa ating mga victim survivors na yung Children's Joy Foundation ay ginagamit bilang front para pilitin yung mga bata na maglimos at magcaroling para mag-fundraise. So, ano po yung status ng accreditation ng CJF? Registered pa po ba yung foundation sa department?
Madam Chair, the license to operate of the Children's Joy Foundation expired last March 2024, and they applied for renewal of its registration and license to operate. It complied, but the DSWD held its application for renewal of license held in abeyance until such time it can prove its financial capacity. So far, we are assessment of issuing the license to operate based on the technical, administrative, and financial capacity of the organization. That's it.
Salamat, Ms. Cherito. And nalimutan ko rin banggitin kanina kay Sir Dindo na yung mga evidence na hinahawakan nila ng alleged pati money laundering no doon sa Canada ay pwedeng kung hindi pa na ipapaabot sa PNP at sa DOJ ay pwede pong maipaabot sa department at saka sa National Police. Sunod Ms. Charito, ano pang ibang KOJC affiliated na charitable organizations o foundations ay rehistrado sa department? At ano yung mga status naman nung mga iyon?
Based on the last hearing po, three organizations were mentioned, to include Children's Joy Foundation Incorporated, which is now the license to operate already expired, and with regards to their children already transferred to other residential facilities. So currently, they are stopped operating now. The 32 children under their supervision is now transferred to other residential facility, registered licensed by the DSWD, or reintegrated to their respective families as well us to place in the foster care families po. The other organizations mentioned previously are the Alay sa May Kapansanan and Handog ng Pagmamahal. Both of them are with expired license and already delisted from the DSWD registration roster of registered and licensed social welfare development agencies, which were already referred to appropriate agencies like Securities and Exchange Commission. Thank you po. We'll give the jurisdictional personalities po. Thank you.
Salamat po, Social Welfare Officer Charito. And kung meron mang sineserbisyohan talaga dun sa Alay sa May Kapansanan, na i-refer na rin po ba sa ibang mga persons with disabilities foundations na maaring mag-partner din sa kanila?
So far, nung nag-validate po, non-existing naman po doon sa location po. Thank you po.
Okay, I see. Ano po yung medium at saka long-term plans ng DSWD sa pagtulong sa rehab at saka reintegration ng mga trafficking survivors, lalo na yung mga babae at bata? Or bahagi po ba yon sa report na isasubmit nyo sa komite?
Madam Chair, yes po, will be included in that report. Thank you po.
Salamat po. And although ito kaugnay din sa DepEd, itatanong ko rin po sa kanila mamaya, dun sa mga batang di nakapag-aral, ano po yung maaaring gawin para i-bridge yung learning gap nila?
Yung mga hindi po nakapag-aral, may mga ilang programa po ang DSWD where we assist them for that specific programs. And if there are, will be transferred to our residential facilities. We also provide educational assistance. Thank you po.
Salamat po. At huli, ano yung ginagawa ng DSWD para makapagbigay ng reparations at livelihood dun sa mga victim survivors na maaring nangangailangan nito?
Maybe we could include that in that report, Madam Chair. Thank you po.
Yes, please do. At maraming salamat, Social Welfare Officer Charito. Salamat po. Para po sa DILG, ayan, si ASEC. ASEC Benitez, yes sir.
Good afternoon, Madam Chair.
Good afternoon, sir. ASEC, may ideya po ba ang DILG kung saan-saan sa Pilipinas nakalocate yung mga miyembro ng KOJC?
Well, as far as primary information is concerned, we always leave that to the PNP, Madam Chair.
And ano po yung mga plano ng department para tulungan yung mga victim survivors?
Well, even during the, well, under the watch of Secretary Abalos and now under the new secretary, the newly minted secretary, Secretary John Big Rimulya, now the department always believes in a whole of government approach, now vis-a-vis this problem. And the primary participation of the department will lie on looking into the possibility of involvement of our local government officials, particularly those with whom the department acquires direct authority. Now, in line with the delegated power of general supervision cascaded by the president in favor of the DIG secretary. So what we're doing here right now is we're trying to identify local government officials in the local level now who had been found remiss in addressing basic deliverables and duties under the law, then probably move forward and proceed with potential case build-up, and then eventually the last stop would be the filing of cases. Now, all of these endeavors are being done in close coordination with the PMP, of course, with the DOJ, now with the other stakeholders in the government. But again, Mr. Chair, with your indulgence, I would like to go back to the initial episodes of this hearing wherein we always emphasize, you know, through this representation, the inadequacy of the department in so far as disciplining our local government officials are concerned. Now, we are basically bereft of any authority to directly discipline our local government official. So that is a, quote and unquote, a mischief probably, now, for which we are being faulted. And we have been trying to now move our best put forward to call the attention of our legislators in particular to probably introduce amendments to the local government code and somehow put flesh and blood and possibly muscle into the authority of the department to discipline our local government officials, not only in the case of trafficking, no, mendicancy and abuses being perpetrated on the minor children that we have, but even the many transgressions being perpetrated by local government officials. If you will remember, Madam Chair, under the same committee, the case of Mayor Guo, in particular, if I can mention that instance, now, the many travesties being committed by local government officials, of which the only possibility that we can do is proceed with the case build-up and eventually file the case in the proper forum. Probably, now, the perspective would have been much more better and probably proactive if the department will have a direct involvement in disciplining our local government officials, Madam Chair.
Maraming salamat para doon, ASEC Benitez, and the committee will really appreciate and i-share po namin sa Senate Committee on Local Governments kung meron pong proposed formulation ang department. Paano nga po mapaganda yung local government code in this aspect? And if I could just follow up, one specific point na itanong ko rin kay Colonel Likud kanina, in terms of yung ginagawa ng department looking into the involvement of local government officials, meron po bang investigation ngayon or fact-finding kung yung local government sa Davao City ay nagprotekta sa anumang illegal activities ni Kibuloy or ng KOJC or ng Angels of Death for that matter?
No, yes, Madam Chair, that is already included in our menu, but at this point in time, we have been prioritizing our fact-finding inquiries. Now, considering the lack of manpower that the department has at the moment, but inarguably that is within our table, and probably after we are done with the POGO issues, because the POGO issues has been or had been ramifying from one area into another, then probably we can set our attention and our energy to the Davao no controversy insofar as this KOGC matters are concerned, Madam Chair. Maraming salamat po.
Maraming salamat din, Asik Benitez, at sa pagtsatsaga talaga ng department sa pagsubaybay sa mga issue na iniimbestiga din po namin sa Senado mula POGOS hanggang itong human trafficking, Kibuloy and KOJC. Lastly po, Asik Benitez, may investigasyon... Okay. Naitanong na rin po ito kanina. Maraming salamat po, Asik Benitez. Sa Dole naman po, sino yung nandito para sa Dole? Meron po ba? Wala. Wala ba, Comsec? Alright, so the committee will just write the department, yung mga labor and employment questions. Para po sa DOJ, and specifically DOJ IACAT, will it be... sino pong magsasalita for DOJ? Senior State Counsel Quintana? Yes, ma'am. Pwede nyo po ba kaming bigyan ng progress update dun sa mga kaso na nakahain na kay Apollo Kibuloy? If there's anything to add from what was earlier discussed. Yeah. Oh, maybe. Yes, so it will be Deputy State Prosecutor Torrevillas. Yes, ma'am.
I cannot discuss the merits of the four cases pending before the Quezon City Court.
Attorney, I'm so sorry. Hindi pa ba kayo nakapagsumpa kanina? Hindi pa po. So may I ask you to? Sorry at this point. Special. Comsec, paki po.
Kindly raise your right hand. Do you swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth in this Senate inquiry proceedings?
Yes, I do.
Yes, Senator. She answered affirmatively.
Salamat, Comsec, at salamat, Deputy State Prosecutor Torrevillas. Yes po, you have the floor on progress update sa mga kaso na inihain kay Kibuloy.
We have the pretrial conference on October 22, both in Regional Trial Court in Quezon City and in Pasig.
Salamat po, Deputy State Prosecutor. And yung susunod ng tanong, kasi ay napag-usapan na rin po ninyo kanina kay Majority Leader Tolentino. So yung update sa extradition request ng US government. So salamat para sa muli sa naunang update dyan. Matanong po si Yusek Tapales ng Council for the Welfare of Children. So ito, pa-ways forward na po tayo, ano ang ating gagawin? Ano po yung sinasabi ng naging buong episode na ito sa estado ng mga batas natin para sa mga bata?
Magandang hapon po sa lahat, sa makabatang hapon po mula sa Council for the Welfare of Children. Kagalang-galang na taga-pangulo, of course na natutuwa ho kami na napakayaman po ng information, kumbaga treasure trove of information po ang narinig natin po ngayon, ano. Pero siguro just to set to give some context, our present laws already address most if not all of the matters addressed today, particularly as early as 1974, PD 603 in section 59 already prohibits improperly exploiting children, using them in begging and other acts inimical to their interest and welfare. That's section 59 item 7, and section 59 item 8, it already inflicts it already prohibits the infliction or inflicting cruel and unusual punishment on children and the deliberate subjecting of children to indignities or excessive chastisement. This particular provision was originally confined to parents, itong section 59 po ng PD 603, but with the enactment of Republic Act 7610 in 1992, in section 10 of Republic Act 7610, this was made to apply to any person who will commit any of the acts enumerated in Article 59 of PD 603. So pinaparusahan na po ito ng ating batas. At of course, we have three trafficking laws already, starting with the 2003 original Trafficking in Persons Act, the 2012 version, and the 2022 amendment. And of course, we leave it to the Philippine National Police and the DOJ on the characterization of the proper offense and of course, the prosecution if so warranted, Madam Chair. But As our ways forward, listening to the discussions and the comments of everybody here, perhaps focusing now on the preventive side, because we have been discussing from the reporting, the rescue, from the prosecution, and to the eventual rehabilitation. Perhaps for the Council of for the Council for the Welfare of Children, because we are currently working with LGUs to standardize or to craft a standardized child protection policy, so the children interacting with LGUs will of course be protected at any times and free or safe from harm from the members of the LGUs themselves and even visitors and other guests of the LGUs. Marami pong mga sitwasyon dyan sa simpleng lulunsad po, kunyari, ng mga programa ng mga LGUs natin, may mga kasamang bata, nagtatransport ng bata, natutulog ang bata, kasama ng mga adults. Yan po ay ilalatag po ng Council for the Welfare of Children at ipopropose po natin yan sa mga local government units, which of course will be measured in the during the execution and implementation of that child-friendly local governance audit. Ano? Ang wala pa po tayo, Madam Chair, at ito po idadagdag natin, is a standardized child protection policy for the private sector. Of course, we have a child protection policy for the schools. The DepEd released their child protection policy, I think, as early as 2012. I think they're one of the earliest, if not the earliest. But with respect to the private sector, like businesses, enterprises, offices, and even in church and religious settings, I'm not sure, I am not aware of any standardized child protection policy or any law, rule, or regulation requiring them to have such a document to, of course, ensure the protection of children while in their care or while belonging to such religion or denomination, or even protecting them from the members or even guests of these religions or denominations. So perhaps as a subject of future legislation, maybe we can look into a proposed legislation, perhaps recommending the adoption of child protection policies in the private sector, in the schools, in church settings, and even local government units. And of course, perhaps delegating the responsibility of monitoring and evaluating the implementation of child protection policies into a sturdy and strong agency, of course, like the Council for the Welfare of Children, and even perhaps a Philippine Commission on Children moving forward, Madam Chair. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you also, Yusek Tapales. So it's beginning to sound like another example tulad nung binanggit din kanina ni, I think it was General Torre, yung whole of nation approach. So nagpa-partner na kayo sa LGUs and then syempre from the get-go with the NGOs, no, civil society, nagpa-partner kayo sa LGUs, nagpo-push kayo ng child protection policy, nagpo-propose ng para sa private sector din, and then iba't ibang institusyon natin from schools, faith communities, at iba pa. So salamat para doon. Lastly po, baka meron kayong gustong idagdag. Ano yung agenda ng Council of the Welfare for Children sa mga child victim survivors ng human trafficking?
Madam Chair, perhaps the most tangible contribution of the Council for the Welfare of Children insofar as violence against children is concerned, the CWC being a policy-making agency is of course the Makabata Helpline 1383, which is being positioned as the main or focal or apex helpline of our government for all children's concerns, of course, covering violence against children, including sexual abuse, whether offline or online. We are in the process of having the Office of the President or the President sign an executive order institutionalizing the Makabata program, which will institutionalize and harmonize all the programs of our government relating to children in need of special protection, which includes children subjected to or victims of violence. And this will standardize the efforts of all of the government from reporting, rescue relief, rehabilitation, and reintegration. Constitution, and this executive order, hopefully when signed, will also institutionalize the Makabata Helpline 1383 as the main reporting mechanism of our government for children. And of course, for the National Children's Month, Madam Chair, we are focusing on child protection and child participation. As the PNP may know, based on the data of the PNP Women and Children Protection Center, for 2023, Madam Chair, they received a total of 18,756 reports of child rights violation, 17,304 of which constitute child abuse, rape, and acts of lasciviousness of children. So the spate of violence against children is still high in our country. That's why we are actively working, of course, with the PNP and the Department of Justice and other national government agencies, and of course our private sector partners and our legislative champions to really make a dent on the high incidence of VAC in our country, Madam Chair.
Maraming salamat, Yusek Tapales. So, ways forward na po tayo, dear colleagues, with our NGOs and our government agencies. Saan nagkulang yung ating lipunan? Yes, actually, I will call first the NGO here. Saan nagkulang ang ating batas? So, Executive Director Ellen ng Center for Migrant Advocacy. So, take first crack at it. Saan nagkulang yung ating batas at yung ating lipunan sa ganitong mga issue?
Thank you, Chair. Pero bago ko sumagot, gusto ko lang pong pasalamatan yung ating mga witnesses. Ito po ay hindi parang simpleng desisyon para lumabas sila at magpahayag ng mga kwento nila. Hindi ito haka-haka. So maraming salamat at hopefully marami pang mag-forward para magsabi ng kanilang mga testimonya. So yun yung una. Yung tungkol sa saan nagkulang batas, sabi nga ni Yusek Tapales, parang marami tayong batas both nationally at saka sa international. Member tayo, nag-ratifika tayo ng optional protocol. Tayo ay state party ng CEDAW. Tayo ay state party ng Convention on the Rights of the Children. So palagay ko po, una, no-note sa atin yung forced labor, child labor, money laundering, trafficking, sexual exploitation. Lahat po yan may batas na sumasakop. Of course, karasan laban sa kababaihan. But as we know as well, tuloy-tuloy din yung mga karanasan ng mga biktima, particular ng mga kababaihan at mga bata. So siguro po at this point, kasi ang usually ang argument ng perpetrator at minsan yung iba pang mga involved, pag walang kaso, walang problema. So pag walang nagre-reklamo, walang problema. So I think this is a situation na kailangan din magbabantay yung ating mga komunidad na maging conscious tayo, especially yung karanasan natin sa Pogo na right in our midst, nandoon yung mga operations nila. So maging mapagbantay at hindi mo na lang iiwanan yung mga usapin ng karahasan sa bata at kababaihan sa mga immediate family members nila. So I think this is one situation na inuulit natin yung pagiging responsable natin bilang mamamayan, bilang kasama ng mga komunidad. And that said, Chair, I think yun nga, kailangan sigurong repasuhin kung kulang yung national legislation. For example, trafficking is a transnational crime. Cross-border, so may mga money laundering, ang KOJC is operating in more than 20 countries or so. Sinabi ng ating PNP, they're already cooperating with the Austrian government or something. Ito yung nangangailangan ng cooperation nung ibang mga bansa. And hopefully, wala naman dyang sasabing kami ay nag-susuporta or nag-kukonsinte ng money laundering or trafficking. As we all know, yung mga NGOs na suspensyahan lang, i-red tag, i-freeze yung assets. So bakit sa ganitong sitwasyon na napakalaki ng operation? And for these people to come out in the open, ay parang ano yan, big decision on their lives, pero ang tagal ng hustisya, ang tagal ng namakamtan, at yun nga, marami pa rin harassment na nararanasan sila as we proceed with this. So ang usapin, sana mapabilis, ma-expedite yung kaso, kasi justice delayed is justice denied. Three decades, Chair, yung kinukwento, at ito ay pababulaan na hindi nangyayari. Isa, siguro pwede kang mag-cast ng doubt, pero ilan yung nagsasabi at pare-pareho ang kwento nila. So I think we need to be more responsible and do something about the situation as soon as possible. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you, Executive Director Ellen. So gusto ko lang tanungin kung may government agency pa tayo dito, like the NBI, the commission, constitutional body like the Commission on Human Rights, siguro yung dalawang iyon, kung meron po kayong maidadagdag dun sa ating pinaka-importanteng closing questions na saan tayo... Opo. At saka yung salamat COMSEC, yung social security system din. No? Although kaugnay po sana yun sa mga tanong sa DOLE. But at least sa CHR at sa NBI, kung meron po kayong gustong idagdag na hindi lang saan tayo nagkulang, no? Yung ating lipunan, yung ating mga batas, pero how do we move forward from all this? Yes, Chair Palpalatok.
Maraming salamat po, Madam Chair. As we are listening to the testimonies of the resource persons, Your Honor, we took note of several issues that may have interest to the Commission on Human Rights, among which are the sexual abuse, dry fasting as spiritual discipline, fundraising activities or forced labor, false and or forced marriage, angels of death involved in supposed threats or killings, and the right to education of children. Ang napansin ko lamang po, while we took note that the relevant government agencies like the Philippine National Police, the Department of Justice are already conducting their mandate for the PNP to investigate and file cases, and for the Department of Justice to prosecute perpetrators. Overlooked, Your Honor, is the function of the Commission on Human Rights. We hope that through this investigation, the parties, the persons involved, whether victims or the accused, would cooperate with the Commission on Human Rights, not only for purposes of enforcing accountability, but more importantly, to determine the actual situation, the human rights situation of the country. And also, for the Commission to arrive at the concrete policy recommendations for concerned government agencies like the legislature, for to address the issues and to provide solutions. Ang isa pa hong napansin ho rin namin ay yung the issues involved abuses on women and children. And this is of interest to us because we are signatory to the, as mentioned earlier, the Convention on the Elimination of All Forms of Discrimination Against Women and the Convention on the Rights of the Child. And yes, we acknowledge that there are several laws already complying with these conventions. And what may be the problem is the implementation and the openness of the public in discussing it and also filing cases against the perpetrators. At ang isa pa ho siguro, ilan pa ho siguro na ma-recommendation is empowerment of the victims. So strengthen ang advocacy po for their rights and how to protect their rights, and also capacity building for relevant agencies of the government, civil society organizations providing assistance to these victims, and also to the Commission on Human Rights. Yun lamang po muna. Thank you.
Thank you, Chair Palpalatok. Meron po ba from the NBI on how do we move forward from this? Deputy Director Magno.
Good afternoon, Madam Chair, and to all the resource persons here. Yes, ma'am. On the part of the NBI, we would like to strengthen our anti-human trafficking division, our BAU City, and of course, to recognize these important roles of our agents in doing their cases. These cases are not simple. These cases goes to the mind, to the soul of every investigator and every agent when doing their work. In this regard, medyo nakukulangan po ang ating mga suporta dito sa ating mga ginagawa na ito. We can hear the testimonies right now, especially the one mentioned about 87,000 cases of child violation, sexual exploitation, hindi po maabot sa aming database yan. And of course, sana po with these reports, considering that the NBI is the national clearinghouse of criminal criminal records, no, we would infuse these datas in our servers so that when the right time comes, magagamit po natin to. Especially with this committee, ma'am, nakita po natin na naumpisa natin yung the Senyor Aguila, ito po ngayon, yung pong PBMA, dumarami na po ito. Of course, this is a very sensitive issue regarding the separation of church and state, freedom of religion. But again, on our efforts with the DOJ, law enforcement, and other agencies, dapat po sigurong mabantayan, mamonitor, para po hindi na umabot sa ganitong kalalim yung magiging sakit na iiwanan ng ganitong mga sitwasyon. Madam Chair, yun lamang po.
Maraming salamat sa NBI.